I gave some thought to how I might do this, and so you're going to have to bear with me in that I may approach it a little differently. But essentially, what I'm going to try and talk about as honestly as I can is a question that we often are not encouraged to think about explicitly, and the question is, how do I think? And from that, we might ask ourselves, how do I heighten the chances of discovery in my work? So if we come back to people like Kleining and Witt, when they were talking about heuristic inquiry, you know, there was a lovely wee essay they wrote about ways that we might use to increase the chance of discovery in our work. So to do this, I'd like to tell you the story of a story. And the talk will have unpicking of that story, and then I'm going to show you the film. It's 18 minutes, it's a short film, and then I'm going to return to a couple of ideas at the end. So, let's see if I got this right. Okay. I found these two ideas very interesting. That in 1955, Hallowell talked about the fact that maybe the skin, this here, is not a division between what is inside and what is outside. That there is this this realm of knowing that is deeply interior, and it was, you know, Bateson picked it up, the same idea, when he said that the mental world, the mind, the world of information processing, is not limited by the skin. So while education often values what can be made explicit because it can be assessed, the danger with that is that it ignores or marginalised what cannot be made explicit. And for people who choose to create as a central driver of their work, that can be difficult. And so what we oftentimes find is methodologies talked about or elevated that deal with the explicit cycles that go through, you know, planning, taking action, reflecting on action, replanning. But it's placed in the realm of the explicit. And then we have talking about this stuff that is not the explicit, but that we know that we respond or work inside or draw on. Ideas of tacit knowing, ideas of working inside unstable environments where the question isn't fixed. So I'm always going to press the wrong button here. Okay, so this idea of that we might dwell inside the unstable or the unknown is nothing new. You know, like if we have a look at Keats, and this, you know, his idea of negative capability, you know, when a man, I'm sorry, he's gender bias here, is capable of being in uncertainties, mysteries, doubts, without any irritable reaching after fact or reason, that we might productively dwell in the space of unknowing, that we might actually seek that out as a way of finding some fertile ground in which to think. You know, Aesold, when he was talking about this, says that he was talking about it in Rediscovery of the Unknown, and he says, it's precisely the ability to tolerate anxiety and fear, to stay in the place of uncertainty, in order to allow the emergence of new thoughts or perceptions. And it's in that space that I want to talk about, because that space has become home to the way that I think. In doing so, I'm going to talk about two films, but I'm going to show the second one. But these are just the trailers for the films. The first was in 2004. It was this film here.
Thank you.
So some reference will be made to that, but the film that we're going to concentrate on is a more recent film, and it's this one here.
I'm going to be an artist.
It's not safe. Do you understand? Keep away from my daughter.
You stay away from that freak.
Fucking pivot! Fuck you!
You won't even stand up to him!
So what I'm going to try and do is unpack an approach to the way that I conceive and make film. I'd like to talk about the couple of ideas from two people that they've always... You know how sometimes you read something and you're going, it's kind of clicking through cognitively, you're going, yes, 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 and then there's a phrase or something jumps out and it doesn't hit your head, it hits your heart. And you go, that's true. On a very visceral level, that's true. And I, a couple of them to do with this is, I was fascinated when Titian, the 16th century Italian artist, who talked about touching the surface of his paper in order to investigate an elusive world just beyond his reach. You know, and that doesn't matter whether we write or whether we draw or whether we paint, that time when we sit with a white piece of paper, for those of us who are tactile, and we sense a world just beyond it, just beyond our reach. And sometimes that can terrify us. You know, we get what I sometimes think of as white fright. It sits there and we go, shit, 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 shit. But it's because I think we sense a huge potential beyond it over which we may not be in control, that we must enter into without a roadmap. We must go into a journey that will take courage and the ability to fail and then recover from failure, that demands a lot more of us than an explicit synthesis of the known. And the other piece was from Byron in his letter in 1822 to Thomas More. And he said, like all imaginative men, I, of course, embody myself with the character while I draw it. Let me read that again. I, of course, embody myself with the character while I draw it, but not a moment after the pen is lifted from the paper. So, in that process of drawing, there is something different to the idea of the drawing as something that we see. Yesterday we heard about the idea that the role of drawing as more than an artifact, but a full entity, a full realm. And it's in that realm that I work. I used to write for television. I wrote terrible crap that you watch on TV. Hopefully you haven't seen it. But, you know, I got paid to write crap. I write TVC, I do write television commercials. But when I die, I want to leave a few things on the earth that might be of some value. And so I walked away from writing as a way of generating, and tried to go to something deeper. So if we have a look at, in 2008, Taylor talked about the types of drawing. And, she said, propositional, preparatory, visionary, imaginative, associative, factual, didactic, generative, transformative, performative. It all seemed very wonderful. But I remember going through the list and going, oh, shit, there's something missing here. What is that kind of drawing that draws into, that is either pursuing what is just out of reach, or when it grasps it, it's not entirely graspable, but it begins to draw something back into being. And so I have a look at this. In the, when I draw, I can talk in a language that can do things that, with my thinking, that words can't. I can think about weight and tension in different ways. I can think about what is revealed and what is not revealed in different ways. So something like a, you know, 4-minute sketch of somebody, and he was just someone who I thought in my imagination might be a younger version of a boy in a feature film I'm working on at the moment. But there are emotions there that words can't touch. But in drawing with it, you can dwell inside them. You can be those things. And maybe, I don't know whether this is the reason or not. I've given up trying to work out how come this happened. I couldn't read or write until I was 15. So I was in a special class. You know, special classes, I think they exist all over the world, except in Finland, as I understand. We have a slightly different education system here. But I was hugely privileged because I was ignored, and I thought through drawing. I just drew and drew and drew and drew and drew. So I began to talk about my world through drawing. When I finally learnt to read, it was very quick, and now I write quite happily. But my preference, when I'm trying to get to more complex ideas, I will move away from writing. That's why I loved listening yesterday when the discussion around, a really interesting question came from the group. Someone said, when you write, do you write by hand or do you write on the computer? It's an interesting question. I'm certain in here there's a whole lot of diversity. I draw by hand. I don't use a tablet. I don't. I draw by hand. And in my first drafts, I write in diagrams, in bits and pieces, not mind maps. I write in diagrams, and I try and find order with them. And then from there, I begin to write. But I don't go onto a computer. No, not even a typewriter. I don't go on to that until the substantial, elegant nature of the thinking has been sorted. So this brings to an interesting idea. In the realm of film, you get your idea funded on its script. So there's these bizarre sayings like, if it doesn't work on the page, it won't work on film. Well, that's bollocks. But it is a deeply held belief. So when you're going to a funding agent, they will go, can we see the script? Now, here's the interesting point. If film essentially is talking pictures, then we think in pictures, translate to it back to words, and then translate that back to pictures. And it seems an odd way to go. And so I'm really interested in what happens when we think in pictures and then make in pictures. And so the advantage with short film is because it doesn't take a lot of money to get it funded. You don't get that interference in it. A feature film is a nightmare. Because if someone's spending $3 million on your film, they want to see it checking all the boxes. So, rather than the concept of scriptum, I prefer this older but related idea that we might think through mark making, through the making of a mark, and that might take the form of a word, or it might take the form of a line, or it might take the form of a splash of, that's coffee. I just paint with Czech crap coffee because it's cheap and I can carry it in my ute and my pickup when I'm driving around. So there's nothing. These are not elegant pictures. These are not pictures as artifacts. They're just thinking. But this is interesting because when I begin to create worlds in which I begin to think. So I will draw something, but it is both what I see in front of me and what I imagine, and they become fused. So it's not objective drawing and it's not imaginative drawing. It's some kind of realm in between. Now, this is not uncommon in the area of film. If you have a look at more recent discourse coming up, especially from practitioners, preempting that, in 2010, Millard discussed how in an era when images and sound play increasingly significant roles, traditional formatting conventions restrict the innovation in screenwriting. So actually questioning whether the training and the conventions of screenwriting really work. Wells had preempted that in 2007, arguing that the role of film ideation and development needs to be broadened to embrace alternative narrative forms. So he says, many innovative screenwriters and filmmakers have long favored audio and visual expressivity over plot and narrative drive. But if you have a look at a really good example of this, which is like nice feet on the concrete sort of response, Wong Kar-wai, 1995, Fallen Angels was the film, insisted on the role of images, sound, and music in the scripting and production process. Work was developed from an idea where abstract lines and forms and shapes and colors were involved. He said, You can't write all of your images on paper. And there are so many things, the sound, the music, the ambience, and also the actors. And when you're writing all these details in a script, the script has no tempo. It is not readable. It is not a good idea to write out a complete script beforehand. And I just wrote down the scenes, some essential details, and the dialogue. I fill up books of drawings. And with those, I can work with actors and I can work with crew. Not to say make these pictures, but I can, because I've dwelt inside each of the characters and environments, and in most of the environments I build them too, as a way of trying to understand them, you get a very deep and intense emotional resonance in the work. So, this is interesting. So if I have a look at what is this kind of drawing? Well, I call it immersive drawing for want of a better word, meaning that it's not the artifact, it's the process in which you become immersed. So Rosenberg talked about a drawing process when one thinks with and through drawing to make discoveries, find new possibilities that give course to ideas and help fashion their eventual form. He also went on, he said, It's a process and always in process. So it's thinking in action and action as thinking. Physical and mental processes are linked isomorphically and crimped together. The process of drawing is at one and the same time mental and physical. That's really interesting because I also think it's emotional. And I'm going to come into that in a little bit. So we oftentimes talk about the materiality and the relationships between muscles and drawing, etc. But I think sometimes we draw this into it too, or we can draw this into it, such that we feel worlds when we work. Okay, so the closest I can come to this is, we're not talking about this. We're not talking about storyboards. That's didactic use of drawing. That is when I sketch out some things to show the camera person how I want that framed, or to talk to the production or to whomever about what we want put together. It's not that. It comes close to, and the closest I've been able to come to this, is the obscure use of the word ecstasy. Now, it's if you think of ecstasy, meaning to stand, causing to stand outside of it. You know, this is the road to Damascus, and whoof, outside and something comes crashing in. Ecstasy is like a reverse of that. It means to stand inside, to be inside. And the idea is not that foreign. If you ever look at Moustakas talking about heuristic inquiry, where he talks about you pull the question in and you dwell with the question inside the self. So it's not there and me doing this to it. It's pulled inside and lived inside, and inside it transforms, and we transform with it. Now, of course, the anxieties around this are, oh yes, but that might be soft and mushy because it's not explicit enough for me to see and for you to show me that you are making the right rigorous steps. That's the paradigm that you're going to use for measuring modes of thinking. You've got a problem. That perhaps what happens what we should be looking at is being able to read the relationships between artifacts and thinkers who have generated artifacts, created artifacts, and listen to that relationship to understand the nature of the thinking, that not all thinking is explicit. So, I think of it like this. So, when I go out to draw, I think a little bit about the German word Denkraum, a thinking room, but I think it's more than a Denkraum. I think it's also an emotional state. So a sketch like that might take 25 minutes. But what it causes me to do is stay there with it. I really loved the discussion yesterday about the camera. You see, I don't take a camera any longer with me because it stopped me seeing. What I started doing was just looking and recording. And I was remembering my photographs, not the place. And so as a method, when I work in an environment, when I'm trying to find if a story might be surfacing from it, I will sit there and I will just draw with crap materials on bits. These are bits of A4, little bits of notebook. There's nothing flash about these things. And sometimes I will flick into words. But sometimes words will be big or small, or they won't even make sense. but I'm trying to think about in colour and tone and texture and language, but they may not. I'm not listening for the words that happen. I'm listening for resonances of stories or events that might occur in that realm. So when you see stuff like this, sometimes there are voices recorded that just are recording what I'm seeing, but the picture can't get. And sometimes I can... This makes me sound like a crazy guy, but I'm trying to tell the truth as much as I can with this. You can hear, but not orally. Okay, you understand. You can hear orally, but not orally voices, or you can hear suggestions of ideas, and they're more than just imagination. They're kind of coming closer. And the time spent not doing an objective drawing. Not making an artifact of the thing, but understanding, for instance, there, I was trying to understand what is the darkness of the smell of mud and what does that do to a person. If you've grown up in your childhood in a world of mud flats, what is the darkness of it? But it's not of a child being dark, and I didn't know that that was what I was finding until I started drawing. So oftentimes these things generate seemingly impossible questions or provocations to try and push, heighten the levels of discovery. And sometimes they become very emotional. And this, it's interesting, in the film, there's an episode in it that came from this drawing. There were these culverts, and I was listening to the sound of the water going through them. And that's a recording of it. And I mixed something over the top there. And while I was drawing, I spilt my coffee, and it ran down the drawing. And I thought, is this what drowning feels like? Is drowning a kind of a darkness that where things don't stay stable anymore? So at the moment I'm working on a feature film about shell shock, and again I'm trying to move away from the ideas that conventional ideas of showing war to go, well, if I pull myself into a world of that, could I find another way of talking about it? So even when I'm working there, I'm also reminded of things like this by Reichman, you know, trying to approach and explore the architecture of the impossible, the altogether other of our invention, the surprise of what is not yet possible in the history of the space in which we find ourselves. You know, talking about a carnival of possibilities in poetics, where the need to grasp and hold is relinquished, and one releases to flight what was held in hand so that one too might move. So, when I started Munted, the film Munted, it's a colloquial New Zealand term. It means to be destroyed beyond repair in quite a brutal way. I started trying to find this kid, Katrina, and I'll give you the origin of the story in a moment. But so I began to draw this. You know how at the end of most of you have really hot summers. At the end of summer, and everything's bleached. And I thought, what would happen to because this is the world. I grew up on a farm. This is what was the end of our summers. It hadn't rained for a long time. The colours were bleached. We were picking blackberries in the dust. It was a rich world, but the clouds were always looming and not quite breaking for rain. And you would wait for the rain, hoping it would come, but it wouldn't come and wouldn't come and wouldn't come. And in that, there was an incredible weight settled over the world. And I thought, so what does a person look like if they are that weather? What would that weather produce as a person? So I started off with sketches more like this, but then they later moved to something much more delicate, like this. And it was from that sketch that I began casting in the film. But let me go back. So here's the story was a short film developed from a process of drawing. Its aim was not, it was to show how poignant story could be developed, not from a script, but from linkages made between the drawn world and the naive story related filmically by a young girl. So in this film, a child is telling us the story. But we come to realize that she's not a reliable narrator. And in that lies the poignancy of the end of it. So what I was trying to do, I don't see myself as a film director. I see myself as a film designer. I hold the word design in quite high esteem. So one of the problems is oftentimes, you know, and I've made films like this or texts like this, they're beautifully styled. They look great, but they have lost emotional impact. They're the kind of movie that you go to and you go, well, it looked great, but did nothing to me, apart from a series of sensations that I received. And I thought, I don't know about you, but to me a great film is one that I walk away from and 3 days later it's sitting with me over a cup of coffee, still probing, still asking, still questioning. So I was trying to work out, is there, but when we, oftentimes when we style, we can lose that emotional resonance. So I was trying to see, is there a way of using very unique styling systems, but using them to maintain or deepen emotional resonance. So these works, my films are emotionally quite hard-hitting. Okay, so where did it come from? New Zealand was back in the 60s and 70s wasn't a nation that was the master of euphemism. So there were things called mental hospitals, which is where you put crazy people. And crazy people were like the women in our rural district who were isolated and had no support systems, and they would have nervous or mental breakdowns. And they would be secretly ferreted off to places like Tokanui Hospital, everybody knew that they were in hospital, but nobody asked. And this was a terrible thing. We learnt an anxiety. It wasn't anxious about having the flu, but if the illness was mental, there was something wrong. So these places functioned as kind of secretive places that you drove past and you knew that people were in them, and you also knew that people in your district had gone to them, but nobody spoke. When I was at college, the year before I got expelled, I was in a class, and it was we were the dumb kids. And one of the things they did was they took the dumb kids into the town to show them the jobs that they could do, which meant shoveling grain out the back of Dalgetty's, working in the sale yards, working in McKenzie's as a shop assistant. So we were, you know, our visions were that far in front of our nose, and we were shown where to go. And I didn't go. I didn't want to go. I forged a note with appalling bad spelling, but I forged a note. And the reason I didn't want to go was because we had a lady who came and stayed with us called Auntie Dot, and she was in and out of Tokanui. And I was afraid that I'd see her when I went out there in my school uniform with the party of gaping kids. I was afraid. So I lied so I didn't have to go. But there was one other person who didn't have to go too, and her name was Denise Bocott. And I said to her, well, so our job was to wash the windows on the classroom. So we were having a smoke and washing the windows on the classroom, and I said to her, why are you not going out? And she told me the story that became the germ of this film. When she was little and growing up, a man from Tokanui came out to their farm, and he actually had Down syndrome, and the years of her childhood were growing up with him as her best friend. And she wanted to be an artist. She wanted to draw. And they became very close friends. And then her brothers one night thought it would be a joke to terrorize the guy. And they went and they beat him up and they paralyzed him, and he was taken back into the hospital. Nothing was ever done. And when the district found out what had happened, they said, oh, he was sexually abusing our sister. Now, Denise said he had never done anything of the sort. He's just a gentle guy who was her best friend. And she wasn't told what had happened. All she was told was that he'd been badly injured and that it was because he was living on his own and he wasn't able to look after himself properly. And that story sat with me for a long, long time, just as we all have stories sitting in our background, some which take evidence and become stories we share with the world, and some which remain and will travel with us into the ground again. So, in the approach to this, oftentimes when you've got films that travel a lot internationally and you've got a very strong dialect, and although I don't speak with it, New Zealand does have a very strong rural dialect, and it was hard to understand, so I had to subtitle it. But I subtitled the film as if it's a children's book, because she tells us with this kind of naive, realise in the last lines of the film is not naivety at all, but a terrifying insight. So the film plays out as if we're, in a way, if you ever look at how type is used in it, or film subtitles, it's used as a picture book. Okay, so when I was in Tokanui, shit, I'm not keeping track of the time here. We going all right? Oh, no, nor do I. So, okay, you just say stop. Make sure you stop. Yeah, I think we'll be okay. Okay. So I broke in there. You're not allowed in there. They're sealed off. But I broke in, and I was walking through the corridors trying to feel what it might be like to have lived in there and then been able to come out onto a farm and live and have a friend. And in the corner of one of the rooms, I found a petal of what I think might have been a lily, but it was the colour. It had no. There's no colour for it. It all colour had been leached out. It was like a wee piece of parchment. And I remember picking it up and turning it in my fingers and thinking, what is this thing that could endure so long and be almost nothing? And that became. I went home and I started to draw lilies, and I started to think what might be the pain of a man who maybe kept lilies or collected lilies. And then I thought, oh shit, no, he's not. No. He's collecting plants. And then I realized that he was a botanist, he wasn't a botanist. He was a botanical artist. And he didn't have Down syndrome. He'd had a brain injury. And the more I drew, he began to talk. And so... But before I come to him talking, I started trying to draw these lilies, and then I realized while I was drawing them that I heard the sound of them dying. Not the oral. I could hear it here. Now, we can't hear the sound of a lily dying, but you can hear the sound of a lily dying. And it was because I was drawing it, I realized that it's the sound of paper, and it's the sound of paper being torn wetly. And I didn't do experiments under the sink. I just knew while I was working that that's what it was. So when you see the opening to the film, the first thing you will hear is a sound of lilies dying in a jar. But the Foley work is simply made out of paper. It comes from the realm of the materials that I was working with. Okay, so what I did, I went home and I set up a vase of lilies in my kiln room. The kiln's now gone, as Marat knows, but I did have a kiln room there. And that's just building paper up behind it. And I painted the background. And I did it manually for 2 weeks. Every 3 hours, I took a photograph. I was sleep deprived at the end of it, but I didn't want to set up a camera to do an automatic time lapse. I wanted to know what it was like to be with flowers while they were dying in a vase. And when I was in there, I'd take the photograph and I would also draw what it felt like sensing the way forward. And the first experiment that I started doing with it looked something like this. I was thinking about how I measured time in it, and then I was using some of the filmed footage and the stains off my coffee paper, and it wasn't working. But I thought that dying lilies in a jar was profound. And, right. So, at the same time, I began to go out to a location. I hunted around for locations where I thought this might be, and I went out and I began to draw. So you see some of those early drawings. And then I imagined things. I was swimming in a waterhole, and it was quite... I like swimming, but I like to know what's underneath me. And there was someone who dumped a pig's head there. They'd been pig hunting. And the eels had all come in to feed. And while I was swimming, an eel ran over my legs, and it gave me the shits. Not literally, but sorry, don't put that on the term. And I thought, oh, the darkness of water, and then I thought, oh, so what if you abandon? Someone threw a pig's head here, but what if someone threw a car here? What would a car look like? It was thrown here and abandoned, and somehow it was dangerous. And in fact, that drawing, a version like that actually appears in the film, although that was not what it was done for. So. I also began to sketch general stores, and I worked with this woman, and I took some sketches of her over lunchtime because I thought she's not. Yvonne is a lovely woman, but I thought she was an old bitch who worked in the store. That's how I saw her. That she would act this. And I started drawing the buildings that I built, sets that I later built. But this is interesting because... all the time, you're working in potential. You're working in the potential of things. So things aren't necessarily locked down, and you're working up multiple levels. That's why I have difficulty when people are asked to describe linear processes of research. When many people don't work like that, they work on multiple layers of stuff. That aren't even consciously choreographed, but if we have a look at Simmel's idea, that things, homologies, or things will attract and connect, and what doesn't will be paralyzed and fall away. And somehow through that process, we begin to get to some cohesive forward motion, some gathering of coherency and cohesion in an idea. So in this, I made every label on every tin in that in that store. The reason was it gave me time to be in there. So that's, in fact, if you look closely, they had silly things written on because I was getting bored. But I was trying to think what might be the nature of a shop like this that was really a collection of moments and commercialized frozen moments in time in a small town. And I also did a produce store out the side of it because I realized at one point when a terrible thing happens that he had to walk into a world that wasn't as brightly colored in the store. So, and I began to draw possible houses. There are two worlds in this. There's the world of Katrina the child and her auntie and auntie's boyfriend. And then there's the world of Don, the botanical artist. And so Katrina's world, I began to try and imagine what that might look like, a kind of a, once had been a beautiful homestead, but these people were poor, it had decayed, they couldn't, and so had their kind of lives done that. And that was what I built in the end, which is quite close to it. It's empty at the back. This was Don's house, eventually, although a few changes, and this is what it was. That's how it is built. Was built. There was one night when I was sleeping out there to try and understand how light worked at night and what you might hear. Okay, and at that time I was reading Heidegger, and I talked about those things that touch your heart, and I thought, shit, that's right. He was talking about, you know, what is thought provoking has not been thought yet. It turns away from us and it withdraws. So thinking it as he describes it is what is drawn into the draft of the withdrawal. It was sensing towards something. Thinking was a process of sensing towards something. So, very briefly, I'm not going to give the full story away, but before the car accident that killed his wife and children, he was a botanical artist. That coal ranger I made out of paper mache. So that's the interior of his house. In the film, the living room, eventually, it was going to be like that. And then I moved out there once I'd built it, and I started living there, and I started drawing using only a kerosene lamp and only the materials he would have had at the time. So this is a poor man in the 1960s. So the paints I were using, you remember those little square things you got in a tray of paints? You put water with them? Some of you might remember this before the cool days of tubes. Well, I painted with those and pencils and bits of charcoal out of the fire. And stained tea-stained paper and ink. So, but what happened was while I was drawing it, I was finding him in there. He would talk up at you, and he'd say, no, no, no. I was trying to draw botanically in different ways to try and find who he had been and what he had become now. And so I'd try clinically, I'd try all these different methods, and some would work and some wouldn't. And I was accruing these piles and piles of stuff. And I just blue-tacked a couple of them up on the wall to keep them out of my road, and I looked and I thought, oh, fuck, that's what you do. Your world is, you live inside, I've been inside your world. That's what, your world is like that. This search to know is your search to know. This fictional man with whom I was acquainted with, that was, his life was close to the method I was pursuing. And so his house, each of these drawings, was troubled by disconnected fragments of intricate poetic writing because sometimes I could hear the words beyond the oral too. And so I was writing, but they were only the residues of being drawn. So they were not artifacts in themselves. They were a process of searching. So it kind of looked like this. I knew I'd had to do a bit of study around this because I knew he'd had a brain injury. So I worked with some people at the university who dealt with brain injuries to try and understand a little bit about it. And what I discovered is that he couldn't hold ideas together for very long. But he was not. I needed him to show residues of incredible intelligence. That this man had been very bright and very sensitive. and that would enable me to build the emotional arc in the world so that the tragedy of the film would be stronger. So that's what his house came to look like. So there were four walls out here too. That was a full room. Those paintings were burnt in one of the scenes, so they don't exist anymore. The only thing that exists are a few pictures that I'll show you now, but they're just digital versions. World was that. This was the interior of my search to know, my search into the unknown to find out, became the way that he talked as a character to us. Because in the film he cannot speak, so his world had to speak for him. And that's why I like, I was so delighted that John Berger's thing came up yesterday. You know, that a drawing of a tree is not a tree, but a tree being looked at. So on one level, you look at that and go, oh, that's a botanical picture of a Agapanthus. But it wasn't. It was a journey to try and find out who this guy was through a process of drawing. These were just the plants, the wild plants that were growing around the area where I was filming. Where I set the film. So sometimes these drawings were quite fictional, quite fantasy-like, because I kept trying to find his pitch within them. Sometimes they were far more clinical, far more kind of technical. Sometimes they showed the pain or anxiety that was in the guy because he was astute enough to know how vulnerable he was. And he was dealing with a terrible emotional incident that had happened. So sometimes the roots helped me a great deal here. And that's why the writing became the same. You know how when something hurts really badly and you go like that, and there's one piece in it, you'll see when his back's against the wall. He doesn't do that, but emotionally he does that. And that came from the Samiris roots. Okay, so enough. So sometimes I tried to approach it really clinically, and I thought, would you have cut this with a knife and laid it out like a specimen? Or would you have worked romantically with it, torn the petals apart, and it be an expression of the beauty and anxiety in you. Okay, so really quickly before we jump to it, that world of drawing folded out into a world of making where things that I discovered and that began to play out. For instance, in the drawing, there's a lot of brown and green, so I made the world of his of Katrina's, the little girl's auntie's world, with a green corrugated iron stove and orange walls. And then everything in her world played out in that palette. The clothing of her mother and the aunt, the men at the time of the party, they all sitting inside the same palette. And that contrasted with Don's world, that I tended to work more in charcoal and coffee, that came closer to this kind of palette. And I used it to kind of suggest very subtly the more artistic and cultured realm. So those are screenshots of his world, where texture and aloneness and soiled, damaged, became watermarked, became part of as the aesthetic. So let me pull all this back before we have a quick look at the film. This is the methodological framework, if you like. Well, I prefer probably to use the word the research design. Is a construct that embraces productive unknowing. So it sees unknowing as pregnant, not as a void. It seeks a form of imaginative embodiment where drawing is employed as a process of thinking and sensing your way forward into the yet to be known. In this process, we forsake the specific and accountable and the predetermined roadmap that is with its fixed question and marked out methodological trajectory. We freely engage emotion as a means of developing higher levels of empathetic texture in the design. So what I wanted to do with these texts, with these films, with what I see as my artistic work in film, was to have it touch something of the human condition and in so doing touch your heart so that when the film is finished, you were moved. And if it didn't do that, then it hadn't worked. So the device that's used in it, basically sitting under, because you were not even meant to notice all of this is just designed to give that, is that you will come into the world, and in Don's world, you will be this close to everything. You will hear lilies die. You will hear every movement of a piece of paper. You will grow this close to him. But in the outside world, we'll be like this. That's so that when the terrible thing happens, you can't get away emotionally from it. So I don't have to make it that graphic for it to be devastating. All that's happened is I've positioned you in two different places when you're in those two different worlds. Okay, so we are in a realm of unknowing and reaching, engaged in a form of instasis that denies the boundaries of the flesh and operates in realms beyond words. That does not mean despite words. Words become part of that, but it is not prescribed by the idea that words hold the primary agent. So the film was really strange. They refused to screen it in New Zealand, and the three New Zealand film festivals refused to screen it because they said it was too dark. And but as with the film before that, which they'd also refused to screen and fund, it did fine when it got offshore, and it won quite a. I haven't put them up there, but it won some awards, but. All that was important was it showed me that it was making a contribution to how film might talk. Okay, so now I'm going to try and make sure I get this right. I'll just show you the film. Have we got 20 minutes, eh? No, we got 20. Right, okay. Okay, so I've got to press escape. And then I've got to press command and F. Is that right? Yeah, command and F. Oh, good. There we go. Command F. Whoops. Command F. Oh, shit. No, that didn't work. Should I just click this? Oh, we've got help coming. Thank you. Lovely. And that's ready to go. Thank you.
He was an artist. He lived alone here before they had the fire. People said there was something wrong with him. Like, because of the way he drew stuff. When I was little, I was a big problem to my mum. So we got sent up here to stay with Auntie Kath. And I liked it here. Most of the time I looked after him, and he'll draw pictures of me. Not just me, but of, like, flowers and hills and all this stuff. He was a really good artist.
£1, please.
don't. My mum had a flash car and a flash boyfriend. Sometimes she'll drive up from the city to see us. But not that often.
Rock, how's my little sister?
Oh, you look amazing.
Thank you. So, where's my daughter?
Well, I thought you'd be happy for me. He's a senior detective.
Oh.
Look, I want her back.
You gave her away, Brooke. You dumped her. Remember, she was 3.
You know why.
Look, you can't just take her away. This is her home.
Look, Kat, she's growing up. She doesn't go to school, and I don't want a feral kid around her.
She's not feral.
She's got no friends. You live out here in the back of nowhere. I want her back. She's my child.
Love, you can't keep her here forever.
Where is she?
She's probably down with Don.
So who's Don?
He rents the cottage. He got into trouble down the South Island a few years ago. Come up here to live now.
Katrina!
Look, I need the income.
Don? Jesus.
That's him.
He looks all right to me. What's wrong with him?
Well, he used to be an artist. And he had some accident. He got brain damaged. Writes all over everything. Doesn't make much sense. Katrina's up here all the time. They might be up the back.
Katrina! Katrina!
Hey, Mum.
Put her down. Katrina, get down. You. Keep away from my daughter.
Mum wanted to take me back to Wellington. But Auntie Cass said no. I stayed here, but she started ringing every night. You could hear them on the phone, banging away at each other. Sometimes Auntie Cass would come away crying.
Right, I can swim.
I used to lie on my bed and pretend I couldn't hear.
Scared? You've spoiled it, though.
Real artists don't write all over their pictures. They just sign their names.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be an artist. Mum's taking me back to Wellington. Or I'll be a hairdresser and have babies. I'll take them back here so you and Auntie Cass can see them.
Mm.
Auntie Cass can't have babies. Mum's the real mother. That's why I have to go and live with her.
Come on. 5 more minutes.
I hate this shirt.
You can't talk like that in Wellington.
Stop going to Wellington.
You can't keep her here forever. Look at her. She's never going to fit in.
I fit in. I get on with people.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's the problem. You stay away from that freak. You shouldn't be hanging around with him. It's not natural.
At the end of summer, when Mum came back, she had information. The police told her his real name wasn't Don. He changed it. He'd been in prison because he killed some little girls. When they let him out, He got sent up here by the welfare. No one was supposed to know.
Left some information at the store?
No.
Yes.
The whole district will see this.
They have a right to know. You don't know what he could do. People like that.
You and your useless bloody boyfriend. You're not looking after her.
She's coming home. She can stay inside for the rest of the day.
Where have you been?
Out.
Did you go down to the beach?
No.
I told you not to go down there.
I haven't been there.
It's not safe. Do you understand?
He said when you drown, it's dark. Kind of black that isn't a colour. Heavy. And you can't breathe. He had 2 children, and they died in the water. And his wife, in a car accident. He was drunk. He showed me photos of them, of his family. It was a secret.
Get out.
I was a good swimmer. Auntie Cass said I was just like a little tadpole. But she wouldn't let me go down there on my own. She said it might look all right, but there were undercurrents there and it wasn't safe.
Don!
He was afraid of the water. Afraid of the dark and the currents that pull you down. Mum was angry with him. She said he could have drowned me, but I was all right. When we got up to the house, she packed my bags and told me we were leaving. I had to stay inside. That night, I remember the men came around for a party.
Well, what have solved the problem? That was a while ago. Big Pig, though, mate.
What was her name?
Big
mate?
Pig.
I'm not talking about Lorena.
Thank you.
My little girl.
Fucking pervert.
I'll let you out of the station.
To raise a fucking bastard.
So far away from my daughter.
Shut up, Brooke.
And what the fuck have you done, you useless piece of shit?
Fuck you!
You won't even stand up to him!
Come on!
Brian. Brian!
Tempted and tried, we're oft made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others living about us, never nobody at his funeral, except Mum, Aunt Kath, and some people from the welfare. I picked some flowers for him, but they forgot to take them. Mum said I had to stay here. I waited for them, but they'll go a really long time. People said he got drowned in his bath, and the men helped to put the fire out. You know, things can happen like that. If you're alone and you don't have any friends to look after you, you've got to be really careful. You've got to fit in. That's just the way it is.
Ran out of time, too much talking, so I guess it's time for questions. Is that right or no? No?
Well, B, if you want to say something, okay. You want to say, you can use your time. We have still 7 minutes time, so
can it's I say one
up
thing?
To you how okay. you want to divide the
I'll
time.
I'll just say one thing. There's some talk in certain universities about a certain responsibility of scholarship, is that we should be a critic and conscience of society. And I take that seriously. It's very easy for us to graft our intellect, our publications onto on worlds that tilt at touching the human condition, but it's also possible for us, and many of us do, concern ourselves with the essence of what it is to be a human being. And that's what I try to do as an artist and a scholar. But of course it is subjective, and in that subjectivity lies its power. So I guess if you've got any questions, but it's okay if you don't.
Okay, I give you 1 minute to frame the questions in your head, and then we go.
This one there.
I just want to be slow.
No, it's true. It's very hard to ask questions after seeing that. Thank you very much. And as you can tell by my accent, I'm a fellow New Zealander.
Yes.
And I knew immediately when I saw the word munted that that this was a New Zealand presentation. But I'm really interested in this idea of kind of knowing and unknowing and what emerges. And I'm thinking about that very much as a New Zealander watching your work and thinking about a kind of not just the emergence of an artist's work, but also the emergence of something that's particularly New Zealand. In a land that's thought of as being a very benign, people often laugh at me because I say New Zealand's not benign, you can go for a walk and not come home, and that there's a dark seam running underneath. And I think that this, you can put your work within a kind of a trajectory of other works. I'm thinking about of children and their kind of dark worlds of imagination. And I'm thinking of Vigil, In My Father's Den, End of the Golden Weather, The God Boy,
heavenly
Once
creatures.
Were Warriors, mm-hmm. Heavenly Creatures, mm-hmm. that there is this kind of, I'm wondering if there's this kind of unknowing, this, you know, I was surprised to hear that it wasn't shown in New Zealand because of its, maybe it's because it's always, we're always showing this kind of very dark side of a country that we proclaim to the world as 100% pure and benign, but in actual fact there's this very problematic seem, and also the role of children. You know, all our films, The Piano, they all have children as these kind of characters who are witnesses to this very dark culture.
That's a comment. I don't think it.
Yeah,
I think your
no,
comment
it
is
more
enclosed.
Of a comment.
Sure.
Yeah, sure.
Sure.
Do you still want to respond?
Just very briefly. Yes, I think they sit inside an anxiety that exists with some of the funding agencies that New Zealand needs to forsake that, and that's why we also have a run of testosterone-loaded comedies that are terrified of what, you know, was called New Zealand Gothic, which I think is a dumbed-down idea. I mean, I look at a lot of Danish film that deals with the shadow in the light, and So my argument is, I think it's, this may sound a little unfair, but I think it's a self-consciousness that we have around the stories we tell about ourselves and an anxiety that we might be seen as too dark. I don't think, in fact, I didn't try to paint any character in there as unrelentingly evil or bad. They were human beings of a condition in an escalating situation. You know, none of them were arch-villains. They were the dark side of all of us. That mixture of two things. But it's a, yes, very strong. Thank you for putting the context in for it.
Okay, then we have still, yeah, okay. Let's steal a little bit coffee break. We take these three questions and then we will go for coffee.
Okay, thank you for a great experience. I have a very small and trivial question, but it's bothering me, the coloring. Mm. What this coffee sepia something, what is the meaning of that for you?
It's not a trivial question. It's a really good question. My other the film that I showed you the little piece of before, Boy, was not coloured like that at all. It seeped into, and when I started thinking about it, it wasn't coloured like this. It actually seeped in because of the process of drawing that I was using and the materials that I was using. That's the colouring that they made. And so if you ever look at Don's drawings, they are the palette of the film. And they either lean towards the sepia, dirty, dusty, grey-browns, or they lean towards these spots of bright colour that are cheaply rendered. So those metallic greens and that horrible burnt orange, they come from cheap palettes. And so that's what that actually came out of the method that I employed in drawing. It seeped out. But it was a really good question. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sure you touched us all, and I feel that emotion is kind of the essential, the very essential in your work. And I understood that you like describing this process of scaping or designing a film is also then it's.
Unknown and potential. So the people with whom I work, all I ask them to be able to do is know what the question is where they are at the moment, but know that that question might change. And that's even quite difficult for my university sometimes, because when we put applications together, it just says this is an emerging question. And so I tend to work, I work in very intimate ways with people. We have lots of cups of coffee, tea in my case. I work closely with people because I think that teaching is essentially a relationship between human beings and potential. So, I love it. I love doing it. So, I look at the people. When I've got a 2-year waiting list on the for the PhD. I know that sounds awful, but I don't actually care what someone's grades are. I care about the risk that they're taking and their propensity to fail and recover. And because I'm not a good, I'm a better teacher for those realms, for those kinds of people. So in answer to your question, and it's not an absolute answer, I tend to work very intimately and emergently. So I don't lock people down to an absolute that goes forward, but I do ask and expect them to be able to name the territory where they're standing at any term, and say where it is that they're going to look now. And then they should be able to conversely reflect back on where they've been as part of that trajectory through a landscape without a roadmap. Does that answer the question? Thank you.
Okay, hi. Thank you for the very, very great presentation and film. I was a little bit worried that if I'm not going to be the first one commenting, I'm not able to anymore take this risk and say all that I would like to say, but I wrote something down while the others spoke. However, you were really, I'm talking about my own experience, trying to take the risk as you do, as I feel that you do already by all this work you do. And you really made me personally dwell in emotions. And I tried to, during the film and also during the presentation, I was trying to figure out what these all these emotions are. Very bodily emotions. I was crying, my heart was pounding fast. I really felt like there were so many, there are, it's so deep, deep thing what you do, is something that it's hard to explain, hard to, but it's very bodily. And also I was trying to figure out what is the most emotion that is like on the surface or the most strongest. And I think I feel really honored, I feel really grateful that there's a person in this world that is doing a job like you do, this sort of so profound, and it feels to me like you're in a constant flow when you present, and it really delivers. It really, I get the message from the film, so I feel really touched, and I thank you very much.
Well, it's a very graced way to end the questions. Thank you. We're going to have a cup of tea now, and which is good. Sometime we were going to play a loop of the drawings that actually were in the film that were photographed that weren't there, but because we're going to have a cup of tea now, that may be playing at some time during the day. One of the things I love about this conference, I saw it at Nord's too, was that for people who are exhibiting, you've got a little bit of paper there and some stickies that you can put comments on. I think the conference has got a great spirit. If you get a chance to write something, some reflection or some question, questions help me. I think if you just stick them there at some time, and Marat will say sometime in the day when that loop will be running. Thank you for being with me for this time. Thank you.